Hi, my name is Jill Smith, and this is my senior seminar for PRM 498C. Today I'm going to talk to you about the impact of environmental education on elementary school age children at the Anne Springs Close Greenway. The Anne Springs Close Greenway is a 2,100-acre nature preserve located 15 miles south of Charlotte, North Carolina, in a small town called Fort Mill, South Carolina. It has 40 miles of trails for hiking, biking, horseback riding, multiple lakes for fishing and kayaking, and there's plenty of space to camp. The land was donated in 1995 by Ann Close's 8 children in honor of their mom for her dedication to outdoor education and the environment. The mission of the Ann Close Springs Greenway is to connect people to nature through recreational and educational activities while fostering a passion for environmental conservation, animal habitat, and the protection of natural resources. The Greenway offers multiple environmental education for children from preschool all the way up to high school. They offer summer camps and after-school programs, but they also offer curriculum-based programs for reptiles and the weather and life cycles. And these programs are more educational programs that help the kids learn actual different particular items, either about the reptiles or the weather. With these programs, they were able to service over 22,000 students in this past year. But how do these multiple environmental education programs conducted by the Anne Springs Close Greenway have an impact on elementary school age children? Elementary education is impactful on students in multiple ways. And today we're going to start off with talking about what the definition of environmental education is, possible barriers of environmental education, and what the benefits of environmental education is on these children. A definition of environmental education starts off with some organized learning that can take place outside, simple programs that students participate outdoors, or they can be an immersion program where the kids actually go out in the wilderness and learn how to backpack, camp, or do survival. And conclude activities such as hiking, biking, and camping. The definition of environmental education has changed over the years. In 1958, G.E. Donaldson and L.E. Donaldson's classic definition was education in, about, and for the outdoors. In 1986, Priest came up with a more current definition, and his was started with a method for learning. He thought it was experiential. He said that it takes place primarily outdoors, and it requires the use of all of your senses, and it is in a relationship involving people and natural resources. This seems to be the current definition that people measure environmental education against. Priest goes on to say that there are two different approaches to environmental education. You have adventure education, which is a focus on outdoors and biking and camping and getting out in the wilderness. And you have an environmental education, which focuses more on ecosystem and making a connection to nature, to people. There are many possible barriers to providing environmental education. You have a conceptual barrier, which is a lack of creative ideas or not even knowing what is considered environmental education. You have a logistical barrier, which is time, no time, no money, and no resources. You have an educational barrier, which is teachers' lack of confidence in the ability to teach environmental education in or outside the classroom. And an attitude barrier, where teachers might not think that environmental education is as important as other subjects, such as math or English. But most of all, the conclusion is that one of the biggest barriers is time and money. No time to research or prepare the materials, and closely behind that was funding. Teachers thinking that they actually have to go on field trips to provide environmental education, not knowing that they could just do some environmental education right there near their classrooms or just step outside their school. Smith, Sebasto, and Smith did a study in 1994. It was done by mailing a survey out randomly to K through 12th grade teachers, asking them about their concepts in teaching environmental education. And the results were that it indicated that teachers needed more training, Their attitudes towards environmental education was pretty positive, but most teachers spent less than an hour a week teaching environmental education to their kids. Researchers agree that there are many barriers to providing environmental education, but that the benefits far outweigh the barriers that might come across. So some of the biggest benefits of environmental education is just the space for kids to move around. They get outside, they can explore, see things that they've never seen before. They can see the clouds going into different patterns. They can pull over logs and see the eggs or the larva of a bug and learn how that is going to turn into a bug or a spider. So getting outdoors is enough for them to explore in a place that they might never have been before. There are many teachable moments in the outdoors in regards to science. These include life cycles, ecology awareness, water cycle, and more. In our first case study, it's titled Student Outcomes and Natural School, and it was written by Malone and Waite in 2016. In their study, they showed that there was a significant disconnect between children and nature because they're not spending enough time outdoors. They're having limited opportunities to explore the outdoors, and not having this experience can be very detrimental to not only their physical well-being, but their mental well-being. And children are lacking the emotional connection to nature that would make them empathetic to environmental issues. And because this they're going to be inheriting this earth that we leave them, it's important for them to have a connection to nature so that they can learn more about the environmental issues that we have and help find a way to solve some of these problems that we have. Malone and Waite also believe, because of these positive benefits of environmental education, that it should be available to all elementary school age children and that the government should be showing this a priority for the kids to be able to keep that connection to nature. But the problem is, because of busy schedules, busy parents, the children aren't getting, they're not getting that relationship with nature and not being able to explore the outdoors. They're losing the opportunity to play freely, and it's impacting their it's impacting their lifestyle and their social skills and their self-esteem. And the Greenway not only offers multiple environmental education programs, they also take programs out to the schools so that children who aren't able to get outdoors or get over to the Greenway, they're still able to get some of the same experiences that the kids that are able to actually get out to the Greenway. Malone also wrote a paper in 2008 that reviewed over 100 studies from around the world, providing evidence that children who learn outside of the classroom are more physically fit, have better motor skills, and they're more confident in self-esteem. They also have a great leadership skills and are more socially competent and more aware and in touch with the environment. In our case study number two, research on outdoor learning. Rickinson in 2004 wrote a study that focused on outdoor visits and field work. They had important conclusions of the impact of being outdoors and long-term memory. Because the kids are getting out there and having fun and exploring, they're able to keep the information in their brain much more easily because they're enjoying what they're doing. So they're being out in the environment, they're learning new and exciting things, and they're remembering it and taking it home and sharing it with their family. They also include that environmental education can have an impact on child's beliefs, attitudes, and on their self-perception, which enforces positivity and self-esteem and helps with their leadership skills. And it helps with their communication skills, too, as they learn how all these things about the environment and they go home to try to tell their parents, they're learning how to communicate better. We now have to focus on what the future issues or concerns that the Greenway has, trying to provide all these environmental education programs to all these children. One of the biggest concerns is staffing needs. The staffing needs increased 38% between 2016 and 2017. At this time, they only have one full-time educator, two part-time educators, four seasonal educators, and interns. And this is to provide programs for multiple counties and for over 22,000 students. Another one of their concerns is funding. The Greenway relies a lot on grants, and it takes staffing and time to research and write these grants. The grants fund programs that have a direct impact on children. One grant that they received was from Duke Energy, which provided the opportunity for 2 years for educators to go out into the local schools for second graders and teach them about reptiles. So these children had an opportunity to learn about what a reptile is and to also be able to touch and feel and sometimes hold a box turtle or a snake. These are opportunities that the students would never get without this funding from this grant that they received. They also do fundraisers, and they do a gala event every year that funds all their summer camp programs for children who might not be able to afford them. And even though they have 2,100 acres at the Greenway, they still have problems with space. They have multiple programs going on at all times, and they can have anywhere from 300 to 500 students on the Greenway at one time. So while you might be conducting a curriculum-based program on reptiles in one area, you've got a couple hundred students with an after-school program in another area. And they have to be very careful with their logistics on making sure that the programs don't overlap. You also have field trips that are coming in, so you have buses coming in with multiple schools and multiple classes, and so this all has to be coordinated around the Greenway. So some of the solutions that the Greenway has come up with, in regards to staffing, they're trying to create more self-facilitating programs. One of those is called History in a Backpack, and what this is they provide a backpack to teachers or parents who volunteer to chaperone this program. The teachers and parents come in for an orientation, and the staff there shows them that the backpack has four different activities for four different places all over the Greenway. And so they come in for the orientation, they learn what's inside this backpack, and then the students arrive about an hour later, and they are divided up into groups. And then the teachers or the parents who have volunteered, they're the ones that facilitate these programs. And so they go all about on the Greenway, and they have an activity at four different spots, and it provides the history and an activity for them to do. They learn about the Pioneer Days, they learn about the Catawba Indians, they learn about the waterway. So they learn all sorts of different activities, and none of it is done by any of the staff, which saves us staffing, but then also the teachers and the parents get to interact with the students. And they're also, in regards to funding, they're trying to create some more revenue-based programs. By doing this, this enables them to provide more free programs to some of the schools if they have a revenue coming in from another area. And what they're doing about space is that they are now trying to use all 2,100 acres. Instead of having the children and the programs in certain areas, they're spreading out to more of the programs. To more of the areas and creating different programs more out and about in the Greenway rather than in certain locations. So the Greenway provides multiple environmental education opportunities for children to connect to nature. And connecting to nature impacts the children by increasing their health and their well-being. And you can see this direct impact on these children when they come back to visit at the Greenway and they bring their family and friends. And they've learned in school or at another program about the reptiles. And so they're able to bring their family and explain to them what a reptile is. They're able to introduce them to the snake or the turtle that they were able to pet. And so you can see that direct impact that they're learning and they're connecting to nature and they're coming back and sharing it with other people. So I thank you very much for listening to me today on the impact of environmental education programs for the elementary school age children at the Greenway.
We were young and restless, pockets full of stars, chasing down the moonlight till the night was ours. All we ever wanted.